Welcome to Rejoice Online, and thank you for joining us wherever you may be this day. We believe that all are welcome without exception at God's table. God loves you. Let us respond to God's grace and love in song.
Oh, Jesus, Son of God, so full of grace and truth, the Father's saving word, so wonderful are you.
Lord, your love came down and served us. Your grace has come and transformed us. May we be people primarily of grace. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So fairness is something that is hardwired into our brain. And we know when somebody's getting something better than us, or when somebody is being treated worse than us as well. We know when things aren't right. We know when, especially we know when we're not being treated fairly. You know, it may be a little easier to ignore when somebody else isn't being treated fairly, but if we feel like we're not being treated fairly, boy, that sets off all kinds of alarms in our brain. And it's not just humans. So there's actually a really cute experiment you can go and watch if you want to, with capuchin monkeys. So capuchin monkeys are these little cute monkeys that they're very social creatures. And so being social creatures, they watch one another. They understand what's going on, not only for them, but also for their neighbors. And so what they measure as their currency is food. And so they have some foods that they like, okay, like cucumbers. You know, that's an acceptable form of food. But it's not near as good as a grape. And so there's this experiment where they're demonstrating that they already have this idea of fairness where, you know, you have one monkey in a cage right next to another monkey and they're given a task to do, to where they're basically are going to take a rock and give it to to the person who's administering the test. And so the first monkey goes and he gives the rock to the person and he gets his reward. He gets a piece of cucumber. And he takes the cucumber and he eats it and he's satisfied with this. But then he sees his colleague or his partner, you know, in the next cage over, do the same thing and get a grape. And all of a sudden, that cucumber is no longer good enough anymore. And so the next time they do the trick or the experiment, they give him a cucumber again. He throws the cucumber back at the tester, shakes his cage in fury, and as the experimenter goes over to the next monkey and gives it a grape, that monkey's satisfied. They do it one more time, where again, they give the first monkey a cucumber for doing this task. Throws the cucumber as hard as he can at the experimenter, shakes the cage, saying, "Hey, this is not fair. This is not right." Now, you don't have to, you can go back and you can do this experiment with your dogs. You know, to where I know my dogs, if I give one something better than the other, they know about it. And certainly in humans, we learn from a really quick age. You know, when somebody seems to be showing favoritism for somebody else, or somebody seems to be giving somebody else something better than what we get. You know, you gave me carrots, he got ice cream. She got a really cool gift when you came back from vacation, and I got a pencil. You know, and you can see that look that people will give you and say, "This is not fair, it's not right." And we certainly see this as we grow up, you know. And we're much less likely to notice it when it's somebody else. But we certainly know when we're not being treated fair, when somebody's getting paid more than us, or when somebody gets an easier sentence than us, or when somebody, because of who they are or what connections they have, they get into a certain job or a certain school, or they get a promotion, or you can go on down that list to where somebody gets treated better than us and we don't think it's right. Now, this is not a new issue. And there's always the danger with justice that it becomes cold and hard, but it also becomes limited to the people who are the people who we think are worthy of it. And that's something that's gone on throughout history. You know, certain groups of people were worthy of, you know, whether it was community or God or fairness, you know, some, and we've had times where we've said, you know, these people are not worthy of it. So we can use them as slaves or use them as property, or we can pay them less than what another person deserves. And, you know, we've been through this continual process of figuring out, and we're not there yet, of figuring out what it means to live in a world that is fairer. I'm not sure that we, this side of the resurrection, will ever see a world that is fair, but fairer. And yet we all have those things that subliminally will make us treat somebody better than somebody else. You know, in the book of James, where he's talking about, you know, you have two people come into worship, and one who's well-dressed and wearing golden rings and is obviously educated and affluent and everything, and you have someone else who comes in who's poor and who's probably unkempt or, you know, certainly is not dressed as well, and you give favoritism to one and not the other. And I think, on the one hand, this is a very normal human thing to do, that we go to that, which we say, that looks attractive, that looks powerful, that looks... And we assign certain things as, that looks good. You know, certain body types at certain times have said, you know, we've said, that looks good. Certain ways of dressing, you know, there is a reason that they call certain things a power suit, to where it portrays that sense of, I have command of the room. I have command of who I am. I know what I'm talking about because I know how to dress. And I will be honest. I mean, I live in that world. I fit in that world. I think about how I dress, how I put an outfit together. Do my shoes have polish? All those different things. And yet, I'm called to remember that a person is not valued based on how they dressed or what they can bring or all these other things. They're valued because of who God has made us. That God has said, you are my child. You are a baptized child of God. You are a part of my creation. You are one who's been created in the image of God, no matter what your body looks like. You know, as we come to the Syrophoenician woman, who Jesus has gone and he's tried to escape, he's tried to have some time away, and yet he can't. And so here comes this woman who refuses to give up. She knows what God can do for her. She knows what Jesus can do for her. And even, and this is absolutely very normal that Jesus does some testing in these situations. That, you know, well, isn't justice that I should take care of those who are the children of God first, the sons of Israel, the ones who are should be the first to inherit? Shouldn't I take care of them first? And again, is that kind of circumscribed justice? Yeah, well, there's this justice for this group. But I'm not sure if there's justice for you, but she refuses to be left out of that. I'll take that which you have said. I'll take your riddle and I'll turn it on its head and say, well, you know, yes, the children should be fed, but even the dogs get the crumbs that fall under the table, and all I'm asking for is a crumb. All I'm asking for is this. You're saying that. Your daughter is healed. Go home. You have what you want. You know, and who gets healed, who doesn't? Well, some of it has to do with perhaps asking. You know, being in the right place at the right time. You know, there is, as Jesus journeys back home, a group that comes to him, and there's a man who is deaf with a speech impediment, and they're able to get Jesus' attention. And Jesus not only touches him, but takes him aside and puts his fingers in his ear and spits and puts his tongue on it, his finger on his tongue and speaks. And, you know, this whole time given to this one individual so that he can be healed and whole again. And I think one of the things that we can get caught up on in this world is we can get so fixated on justice and on the systems that we have that we lose sight of grace. And, you know, we as Lutherans especially are grace people. And we've always had this little bit of struggle with the book of James, you know, the whole idea that faith without works is dead. You know, on the one hand, you know, we are faith alone people. That faith is that which does something. It does something in us. It does something in the world. And at the same point, if we are recipients of God's grace and we live in a way that doesn't reflect that, is our faith doing anything? And I'll be the first to admit, I don't know the full answer to that. I have my suspicions that it may not be doing anything yet. But I do believe that we are called to be people of grace, people who, when somebody comes to us, that we have that soft heart that says, I may not know how to respond fully, but I'm going to do what I can. I'm going to live as a person who sees that person and responds when I can with grace and compassion. Now, that doesn't mean that justice isn't important. It doesn't mean that fairness isn't important. I believe that they are. But I also think that alongside of them, we need compassion, we need love, we need grace, we need that which God grants to us. And I believe that it's only in the midst of that compassion and love and grace that justice can become more and more like it's supposed to be. Because we begin to see that other. We begin to hear what they have to say. We begin to listen to a perspective that's not ours. And we enter that space where somebody else can say, I hear what you're saying, but here's what I need, and I'm worthy of that. I'm worthy of that because God has made me worthy. I'm worthy of that because I, too, am shaped and informed in the image of God. You know, this is a wrestling that we're not going to solve today. You know, we've been wrestling with this for thousands of years. The people of Israel wrestled with it. The church has wrestled with it. And we wrestle with it. You know, justice is a work in progress. And yet, I trust that God's grace enters into this world and allows us to see in that other person something more than the world would see, something more than what others in our society might see. Because God has placed something in us which can see the great faith in the woman, that can see in the poor person who enters in our midst another person shaped and formed in the image of God. And so may we be continually shaped, be people of grace in the midst of this world. Thanks be to God. Amen.
God's word and love this day, we are called to reflect both to the world around us. May you feel Christ's presence in the upcoming week and be surrounded by the comfort that comes with that. Now go in peace and in love.